think we're ready to start now. It's been a day of political speeches, so bottom of the list. Painters often look back at their earlier work and wonder, like I have, whether it's better than what they're doing right now. And sometimes the answer's no, it isn't better. It's got a freshness, it's got a liveliness, which perhaps the attainment of skill tends to soften down a bit. Skill takes the place sometimes of passion, and I think in the earlier work there's a certain passion which is often missing in one's later works. I'd like to start with, I'm going to talk about pictures individually, and you can ask questions afterwards. These are the earliest works here, and they were made in 1947-48, when I was probably 15, I think. And they're based on personal experience, as most works often are. This one in particular was inspired by, I use the word inspired, which is rather grand, but it came about because I had at the end of my street at that time someone called a bookies runner. Those of the older generation know what a bookies runner was. They took the bets, which was then an illegal occupation. Betting was illegal. So the bookies runner would stand on the street corner looking for the policeman whilst the betting agent took the betting money. Suddenly, through my front door, this man, total stranger, ran through the house, through the front door, and back out, and over the garden fence and away. And what had happened, of course, was he was a bookies runner, and a policeman came up, but the policeman didn't come to the house. He stopped and realised it was a lost case. But that, in a way, was the inspiration. But instead of that, I turned it into a thief rather than a bookies runner, which I thought might be a bit too complicated. This market scene really was part of my background insofar as I lived close to a market, Southwark Park Road Market in Bermondsey. And I did actually work on a sheet music store for many years as a teenager, helping to sell sheet music. And what fascinated me about it was the cries, the actual cries of the costermongers, all with their different notes, high notes and low notes. It quite fascinated me. And so I made this sort of curious scene. But they are, looking back on them, of course they are naive, being made at that age. I'd only just started art school, so I hadn't really developed my drawing skills to that extent. These works followed suit, and this one, interestingly enough, has a corner shop. And when I was looking at it the other day, it suddenly struck me how important the corner shop was before the age of the supermarket. It was quite extraordinary. And that hadn't occurred to me how people relied on going 2 minutes up the road to buy a bottle of milk or something, coming back. And the other thing about it was a sort of, I suppose a sort of, you can't really see it, but there's a sort of curious arched building, which is quite eccentric, that no longer exists, of course. This one, I actually paid homage to the railway arches which cross London, South London in particular, because of the fact that we had no tube line, has an extraordinary network of railway arches, which are quite amazing, from Bermondsey to Deptford and so on. Apparently, originally, they were thought to be good habitats for people to live in. And the original builders tried to hire them out as domestic spaces. No one wanted to live in them. So in the end, of course, they became warehouses, places where people stored fertilizer and such. And thus, causing the most dreadful smells in that. You can't really see down here very much. There is a picture here, which you can look at later, of St Paul's. And I went with a friend who later became quite famous, a chap called Jürgen Hugo, and we were students together, and we were drawing in St Paul's. And we found that in a huge area before St Paul's, all the buildings had been destroyed, and we had basements open to the atmosphere, basement after basement, hundreds of them. And in one of them, we saw some Hessian cases, which had formerly contained presumably tea or something. And so, thinking that it might have made quite good painting material, rather like canvas, we hesitantly climbed down into the basement and began to cut the caps off. Then suddenly we were interrupted by the most enormous swear words I've ever heard in my life. And we looked up and saw a policeman leaning over the edge of the space and yelling the most incredible insults. And it was almost as if we'd robbed a bank. But anyway, he started to clamber down with what intentions I can't imagine. And while he clambered down one side, we clambered up the other side. And this activity went on for some 10 minutes. Until in the end, with a string of curses, he rushed off. And we managed to get our Hessian, which was useless anyway. It was far too slack. But the night watchman has become a favourite print. I think I've sold more prints of the night watchman than anything else I've ever done. And it reminds one of a time when building materials were left in the road by the side of the curb. And in, of course, the late 40s and 50s, building materials were quite scarce. And had they been left there by themselves, they would have soon disappeared. So it was necessary to have a watchman guarding over them. The watchman had his own little hut, as you probably remember, his own little canvas shelter. And I was often intrigued by this, and I made several works on that theme. This is actually from the area near Cherry Garden Pier in Rotherhithe, looking towards Wapping. But of course, it's nothing to do with topography at all. It's quite imaginative. And it simply shows two dockers loading casks. But at that time, I'd only heard about it from my family, who all worked on the Thames in various capacities. My grandfather was a lighterman. And then he tried to put his sons into jobs on land. They all went back onto the river in various either stevedores or dockers. And so I sort of grew up, in a way, I grew up with the smell of various cargoes in the hold, because clothes used to get soiled with odd sort of materials like oatmeal and all sorts of fertilizers. Terrible smell, so there was always this slight sort of hue in the hallway. Murray hanging washing. Murray actually existed, and it's quite true to life that at 10 o'clock in the morning, quite regularly, every morning, she would come out with a huge bundle of washing and hang it on the line. And this was a daily ritual. And I found it quite fascinating because the whole area was under development. this was a point when the prefabs, it was a prefab village, but the prefabs at this time were beginning to disappear. And this is in the hinterland between the new flat developments and the old prefab villages. And there's a sort of wasteland beyond that you can't see. But Murray, I saw Murray as a heroic figure, some sort of, with this gesture of defiance, you know, actually getting on with a daily job. There's a portrait of my father, who I've been told by several people is a very handsome man, so I'm pleased about that, very pleased to hear that. When I came back from being an evacuee from Devon, where I had a glorious time, the war for me was wonderful. I thought I had a wonderful war. I'm very sorry to say that, but for me, going to Devon was such an eye-opener. And coming back to London after Devon, I think, brought this sort of culture shock a bit into the works, where the sort of ugliness of London manifested itself. And I was reminded of a remark that Ruskin made in an essay about how the English love ugliness. I don't know whether this is true, but I think there might be a note of truth in this. When you think of Hogarth, you know, sort of figures, and Edward Burrow, you know, there's quite a lot of artists who really enjoy the ugliness of life. But anyway, it did come into this work a little bit, I know. Apart from the corner shop, there were these elements of ugliness which I enjoyed extremely at that point. Now, coming back from Devon, I was pretty soon rehoused in a prefab because my own house was bombed in the war, and we became part of the prefab village community. And we always joke that the prefab people would marry each other and produce a prefab generation. as I mentioned, it was on the hinterland of the prefabs, just about disappearing. But after the prefab period, I was rehoused temporarily in flats as the prefabs came down, and then I moved to Greenwich, where I was back on the river again, which I enjoyed very much. And before leaving Greenwich, I spent quite a long time in Shad Thames, which is quite near Tower Bridge. You all know it, I'm sure. And it had this extraordinary surrealist mood about it. And one would go there, and there'd be no figures at all. It was dead silence. And there was this weird sort of pattern of shadows and shapes, which were quite extraordinary. And I often wondered why more artists didn't actually go there and work, because it was so pictorially full of possibilities. After going to art school at the age of 13, which was terribly young, we went into something called the juniors, which was really a lot of children running riot and giving the teachers hell. But the serious ones, the ones who were serious, got the very best teaching in the world. They had the best tutors, Keith Ford, John Minton, Victor Passmore. All these people were giving us lessons every day. And I think that we were so lucky to have been at that period, the post-war period, when things hadn't become too grand.